Good morning. I'm Jim Harvin, your lay leader for today. And thank you for attending the service of the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Lower Bucks on this beautiful, bright winter day. And welcome. Welcome to this congregation where we have been seeking to foster community, to grow our spirits, to serve others, and to work for justice for what's now over 55 years. We are very glad that you have joined us this morning in our sacred cyberspace, and hope that here you will experience love, acceptance, and inspiration. After our service, please feel welcome to join us for fellowship and conversation. We will continue with the monthly touchstone themes. For the month of February, our theme is power. Mahatma Gandhi is a reminder that we all possess power. The problem is that we often struggle with our power by denying it or misusing it, or at times by even abusing it. As Marianne Williamson writes, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. Using power is not easy. Our tools include reason, nonviolence, and courage to oppose hatred, violence, deceit, and more. Power is used best with humility and with the objective of creating a win-win result, which is best done when we seek to empower others. Today's sermon is from Mark Bernstein. And we welcome again to our pulpit. Mark serves as an adjunct staff for the Central East region of the UUA. He likes to think of himself as a powerful force in the growth of his congregation, the UU Church of Delaware County in Media. His sermon for today is the language of the unheard. Power dynamics play as much of a role in our congregational life as joys and concerns and coffee hour. Remember an actual coffee hour with coffee? How does power serve us and hurt us, both in our congregations and in the wider world? Now, let us enter into worship together. We will now hear from our esteemed musician, Avi Wisnia, for the prelude.
Good morning. You know, there is power in being together as a community. And that's what this song by the Youngbloods is about. We start this morning by singing a song, Get Together, and feel free to join me if you know the chorus. But a song to sing, and fear's the way we die. You can make the mountains ring or make the angels cry. Though the bird is on the wing and you may not know why. Come on, people, now smile on each other, everybody. Try to love one another right now. Some may come and some may go, we shall surely pass. When the one that left us here returns for us at last. We are but a moment's sunlight fading in the grass. Try to love one another. the key to love and fear all in your trembling hand. Just one key unlocks them both, it's there at your command. Come on, people now, smile on each other, everybody get together, try to love one another.
Thank you, Avi. We officially open our service by lighting the chalice. Please recite with me, as you are so moved, the following words. Mindful that with great power comes great responsibility, we light this chalice in the hopes that in the brightest day, in the blackest night, our faith will flame on. Our opening words are by Martha Kirby Capital. In this hour, may we be open to a rededication of treasured friendships, a renewal of spirit. May we relinquish the worries and anxieties of the past week, if just for this hour, and regain our strength through this community of faith. And now, Beck Stau will provide our message for all ages.
Good morning, I'm Beck Stau, and our message for all ages today is Rosie Revere, Engineer, by Andrea Beatty and illustrated by David Roberts. This is the story of Rosie Revere, who dreamed of becoming a great engineer. In Lila Greer's classroom at Blue River Creek, young Rosie sat shyly, not daring to speak. But when no one saw her, she peeked in the trash for treasures to add to her engineer's stash. And late at night, Rosie rolled up her sleeves and built in her hideaway under the eaves. Alone in her attic, the moon high above, dear Rosie made gadgets and gizmos she loved. And when she grew sleepy, she hid her machines far under the bed where they'd never be seen. When Rosie was young, she had not been so shy. She worked with her hair swooping over one eye and made fine inventions for uncles and aunts, a hot dog dispenser and helium pants. The uncle she loved most was Zookeeper Fred. She made him a hat to keep snakes off his head, from parts of a fan and some cheddar cheese spray, which everyone knows keeps the pythons away. And when it was finished, young Rosie was proud, but Fred slapped his knee and he chuckled out loud. He laughed till he wheezed, his eyes filled with tears, all to the horror of Rosie Revere, who stood there, embarrassed, perplexed, and dismayed. She looked at the cheese hat and then looked away. "I love it," Fred hooted. "Oh, truly I do." But Rosie Revere knew that could not be true. She stuck the cheese hat on the back of her shelf, and after that day kept her dreams to herself. And that's how it went, until one autumn day, her oldest relation showed up for a stay. Her great-great-aunt Rose was a true dynamo who'd worked building airplanes a long time ago. She told Rosie tales of the things she had done and the goals she had checked off her list one by one. She gave a sad smile as she looked to the sky. "The only thrill left on my list is to fly. But time never lingers as long as it seems. I'll chalk that one up to an old lady's dreams." That night, as Rosie lay wide-eyed in bed, a daring idea crept into her head. Could she build a gizmo to help her aunt fly? She looked at the cheese hat and said, "No, not I." But questions are tricky and some hold on tight, and this one kept Rosie awake through the night. So when dawn approached and red streaks lit the sky, young Rosie knew just how to make her aunt fly. She worked and she worked till the day was half gone, then hauled her cheese copter out onto the lawn to give her invention a test, just to see the ridiculous flop it might turn out to be. Strapped into the cockpit, she flipped on the switch. The helio cheese copter sputtered and twitched. It floated a moment and whirled round and round, then froze for a heartbeat and crashed to the ground. Then Rosie heard laughter and turned round to see the old woman laughing and slapping her knee. She laughed till she wheezed and her eyes filled with tears, all to the horror of Rosie Revere, who thought, oh no, never, not ever again will I try to build something to sputter or spin, or build with a lever, a switch, or a gear, and never will I be a great engineer. She turned round to leave, but then great-great-aunt Rose grabbed hold of young Rosie and pulled her in close and hugged her and kissed her and started to cry. You did it, hooray, it's the perfect first try. The great flop is over, it's time for the next. Young Rosie was baffled, embarrassed, perplexed. I failed, said dear Rosie. It's just made of trash. Didn't you see the cheese copter crashed? Yes, said her great aunt. It crashed, that is true. But first it did just what it needed to do. Before it crashed, Rosie, before that, it flew. Your brilliant first flop was a raging success. Come on, let's get busy and on to the next. She handed a notebook to Rosie Revere, who smiled at her aunt as it all became clear. Life might have its failures, but this was not it. The only true failure can come if you quit. They worked till the sun sneaked away to its bed. Aunt Rosie tied her headscarf around Rosie's head and sent her to sleep with a smile ear to ear, to dream the bold dreams of a great engineer. At Blue River Creek, all the kids in grade 2 build gizmos and gadgets and doohickeys too. With each perfect failure, they all stand and cheer, but none quite as proudly as Rosie Revere. With gratitude to our parents and grandparents' generation for doing what was needed when it was needed the most.
Thank you, Bex. Ideas, inspiration, determination, and a little help are truly power. And now, let's hear our interlude from Avi.
Today's interlude is one that we can all sing together. It comes to us from the hymnal, number 346, Come Sing a Song With Me.
Come sing a song with me. Come sing a song with me. Come sing a song with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Come dream a dream with me. Come dream a dream with me. Come dream a dream with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song. I know your mind, and I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time.
Thank you, Avi. I always enjoy that song. And now we welcome Mark Bernstein for his reading.
Thank you, Jim. Good morning, everyone. Once again, it is wonderful to be back with all of you. This morning's reading are the words of the Reverend Tom Shada, who served the First Unitarian Church in Worcester, Massachusetts, until his retirement in 2013, and currently serves on the UUA Board of Trustees. He writes, "There is a power at work in the universe. It works through human hands, but it was not made by human hands. It is a creative, sustaining, and transforming power, and we can trust that power with our lives. It will sustain us whenever we take a stand on the side of love, whenever we take a stand for peace and justice, whenever we take a risk. Trust in that power. We are together held by that power." The words of Reverend Tom Shada.
Thank you, Mark. I always think of the town, as you pronounce it, Worcester or Worcester. Up there in Massachusetts, they say Worcester. Our offertory is next, and the split plate recipient for the month of February is the Valley Youth House and their Synergy Project. Last month, Advocates for Homeless and Those in Need was a recipient of our split plate for the Code Blue program, which serves adults who are homeless in the Lower Bucks area. There exists another program to help younger adults and children, and that is the Valley Youth House and their Synergy Project. These aim to help those under the age of 21. The Synergy Project is focused on connecting with this population on the streets, providing food, toiletries, and other essentials. Young people in need are introduced to and encouraged to use these available services. Since February is a bitterly cold month, as we've been noticing, please help Valley Youth House and the Synergy Project with a generous donation. And for more information, please visit valleyyouthhouse.org and valleyyouthhouse.org/program/street-outreach/synergy. And we'll continue hearing the words from Mark with his sermon.
Thanks, Jim. In 2006, I began training human service professionals in a 4-day train the trainer series, leading to an instructor certification for each of the students. And I continued to do that to this day. These were the best and the brightest from several agencies working in the field of disabilities. And the expectation was that they would return to their agencies and teach the curriculum that they were currently learning from me. In one of those classes, I noticed that several students were eyeing their cell phones during our time together, despite my ground rule that texting was taboo during classroom time. And so I did something that I had never done before. I grabbed a canvas bag and instructed the students to put their cell phones in it, notifying them that they would be returned to them at the end of the day. As I walked among the desks collecting cell phones, I did not think for a second that this would work. I kept expecting someone to say no, to become indignant. Perhaps someone would storm out of the room, but no one did. Despite some unintelligible grumbling, they passively inserted their cell phones into the bag as I walked by. The significance of this exercise hit me immediately. They complied with my request, however outrageous I thought it was, because I was in charge. I was the authority. I had the ability to insert my will and require those innocent darlings to do something that they didn't want to do. I had realized the power of my power. My message this morning is all about power and power dynamics. It is the term used to describe how varied levels of power of two or more people or groups impact their relationships with one another. Power dynamics exist in virtually every setting and relationship we have, in social situations, in professional settings, and yes, in our congregations as well. I'll address the nature of power dynamics in congregational life in a bit, but I wanted to talk first about power as it plays out in the wider world, in this broken world that we are forced to witness every day. On our city streets, in our schools and town halls, on social media, and across the globe, we see power struggles around mask wearing, vaccinations, reproductive rights, book banning, critical race theory, patriotism, and whether Tom Brady is the greatest of them all. He's not. Most of these struggles revolve around active and visible protests. The many Black Lives Matter rallies in protest of another act of injustice toward Black, Indigenous, and people of color. Truckers blocking the Ambassador Bridge between Detroit and Windsor, Ontario. Firefighters in New York City calling out sick in protest of the vaccination mandate. And students in Lancashire, Illinois demonstrate in protest of having to wear masks. Teachers in Chesterfield County, Virginia, calling out sick in protest of having the mask mandate lifted. Rallies in front of the Supreme Court building and state courthouses, some arguing for abortion rights, others demanding right to life. What do all these events have in common? They are displays of power in response to the perceived imposition of power by others. Martin Luther King wrote, "A riot is the language of the unheard." The language of the unheard. Human beings seek a measure of control over their lives, and when they don't feel they are in control, when they don't feel that they are being treated fairly, when they believe that no one is listening, then they will rise up in protest, in demonstration, and often in anger. I want to share with you an extraordinary example of how this idea of being treated unfairly can result in rebellious and even aggressive behavior. This is an experiment that was conducted years ago at Emory University in Atlanta. They use different species, but in the video you are about to see, the subjects are capuchin monkeys. The monkeys were trained on a simple task. They were given a rock, and they had to give the rock back to the researcher. Now, monkeys were trained using cucumbers, and they will work for cucumbers, but they're not crazy about them. I mean, who really is, right? What monkeys do love, though, are grapes. So in this video that you're about to see, the first monkey does the task and is given a cucumber. The second monkey does the same task and is rewarded with a grape. The first monkey sees the second monkey get a grape, but when the first monkey does the task again, she's given a cucumber again, and you will see how the monkey reacts.
Getting grape, and you will see what happens. So she gives a rock to us, that's the task, and we give her a piece of cucumber and she eats it. The other one needs to give a rock to us, and that's what she does. And she gets a grape, and she eats it. The other one sees that, she gives a rock to us now, gets again cucumber. She tests the rock now against the wall. She needs to give it to us. And she gets cucumber again.
That poor monkey. It only took one trial for the monkey to realize that she wasn't being treated fairly, and she reacted in what she thought was an appropriate way. And you don't have to be a capuchin monkey to relate to the frustration and even the pain of being treated unfairly. My colleague Michael Partee writes that violence in most forms is the language of the unheard, the unconsidered, the dismissed, and the misunderstood. And I would add, the marginalized. And speaking of those who are marginalized, an important point needs to be made here before we move on. Power comes from a variety of sources, some of them earned or taken, some of them intentional or arbitrary. One of the most commonly unrecognized sources of power is privilege. In addition to making power easier to acquire, privilege also affords one power over the corresponding marginalized groups. Without that person of privilege having to do anything to accept it or wield it, privilege is always present in the power dynamics of our congregations. Those who hold power and authority in our society must leave room for others to be heard, to be understood, to be acknowledged. It won't cure all of the ills, but it will certainly help. Let's turn our attention to congregational life now, because we're not going to be able to change the world, today at least. Power dynamics in our congregations play out in much the same way as the world we live in. Those who hold power exhibit it in various ways, as I'll describe in a moment, and those who are not in power either conform or disengage or struggle to maintain some type of control over events in the congregation. Who holds the power in our Unitarian Universalist congregations? It depends on how you define power. Social science research suggests five types of power in organizations. For our purposes, I'll focus on three that I believe are relevant: legitimate power, expert power, and referent power. Legitimate power is wielded by people who have been elected or officially designated to hold a position of power. It is the power one has through a role that they fill. Expert power, the second, is often the most enduring, as it is based not on a person's title or position, but on their skills and knowledge. An expert can use this power to get things done their way, to be a significant voice and influence in the congregation. And finally, there is reverent power, given to those who may have been elected or not, formally recognized as a leader or not. Reverent power is gained through an individual's character and personality, through being liked and respected by their followers. Those with reverent power lead by example. They keep their promises. They're open to new ideas. They ask for input, and they lead through demonstration and inspiration. They own up to errors that they have made, and they apologize for them. They take more than their share of the blame, and they give more of the credit to others. They exhibit trust, and they are worthy of being trusted. They are true to themselves and to our Unitarian Universalist principles and values. In my leadership training, I refer to these leaders as WHO leaders, WHO. They lead not by virtue of their title or position, but by virtue of who they are and what they stand for. There are those who hold power and those who respond to those who hold power in various ways. How these power dynamics play out in our congregations often determine the congregation's morale, effectiveness, and sustainability. There is one more source of power, though, that cannot be ignored and perhaps is the most important source of power, and that is the power of the people in the congregation. The very nature of a covenantal community is that we create structures and processes whose success is maintained only by the will of the people, by the promises that we make to each other. And that power stems from the relationships that we form with each other. Margaret Wheatley wrote, "In organizations, real power and energy is generated through relationships. The patterns of relationships and the capacities to form them are more important than tasks, functions, roles, and positions." Perhaps this is the power that Tom Schotter referred to in the opening reading, the power that is at work in the universe, the power that sustains us whenever we take a stand on the side of love, take a stand for justice and peace, whenever we take a risk. It is through these relationships, through our shared experiences, through our conviction that we are in this together, that true power is released. The successful congregation is one where everyone understands that the congregation belongs to them, that they are owners and have as much stake in its success as anyone else. This, in turn, creates greater accountability, which author and community organizer Peter Block defines as the willingness to acknowledge that we have participated in creating the conditions we wish to see changed. When one feels a sense of ownership, there is less chance that he or she will leave the table when things get tough, or wash their hands of the place when they become discouraged. If we, as members of a congregation, do not feel ownership in the process, we will not assume accountability in ensuring its success. Author Patrick Lencioni writes, "What keeps us stuck is the belief that someone or something else needs to change before we move forward. What gets us unstuck, he writes, is the acknowledgement that we are accountable for what is happening. Ultimately, then, the power to transform the congregation must come from the commitment of its members to do so. Leaders who recognize this, who create a sense of ownership and accountability, are the ones who wield their power most effectively. The author Veronica Tugaleva wrote, "There are few things more powerful than people united." Stay united, people. Thanks for listening. And you can have your cell phones back now.
Thank you, Mark. So at this time in our service, we recognize and lift up one another in love. Let us be fully present and listen with open hearts. And if you wish to share something now, please click on reactions and then click on raise hands, and we will help you to unmute. And for everyone's benefit, please be brief as we share our joys and sorrows. Dallas. Jeff, I think you raised your hand.
Yeah, I'm grateful that this Wednesday they're going to be showing, it was a film I made that prepared last August called Black Cases, about the justice system, how the Black and brown young community, the adultification of juveniles, will be shown on Facebook at 8 this Wednesday, the 23rd. I play the judge in it, last scene. If you go to facebook.com/5shorts, these are short films, this lasts 15 minutes, 5 Shorts Project, then you'll see a page, and somehow they're gonna show the film there and then talk to the actors. I don't know how that's going to be, you know, done, but it's worth checking out. It was nominated for Best Picture and Best Actor in the International Black Panther Film Festival. It's a great, great film. I was proud to be part of it. So, encourage you all to check it out.
Thank you, Jeff.
Nancy.
Hi, everybody. I wanted to give you an update on Bill Edwards. He is home, but is extremely weak and is only on pureed foods and a liquid diet. So Robin said they're trying to keep him happy with smoothies and things. But she says if anybody's got any hints on how to make a better food source that could keep him happy, it would be really helpful. So if anybody has any hints and has been through this before, she would really love it. The other thing is Jane is having a pacemaker put in this Wednesday. Mm-hmm. So they've got a lot on their plate. I've asked her if she could use any help or if we could do anything for her. But at this point, I think they're just taking it day to day, and cards are still welcome, of course, and probably phone calls, but that's about it for right now.
Thank you, Nancy.
Mary Beth.
And Mary Beth.
Okay, I just wanted to share that I spoke to Laura, our member, Laura Weinstein, yesterday, and she told me that she'd been in the hospital this week for a kidney infection. She's home and doing better. Her daughter-in-law was with her earlier in the week, and her son Lloyd is there today. So I'm sure she'd like to hear from people if they want to give her a call. So,
cards. Thank you, Mary. Is there anyone else who has a joy or sorrow? If not, whether or not you share today, For your joys, we in this community join you in celebration. And for any sorrows or concerns, may you feel our sympathy and compassion. Let's pause for just a moment of gratitude, silent meditation, and prayer. And now, Avi will provide us the closing song.
We conclude today with a popular folk song by Lee Hayes and Pete Seeger. Join me in If I Had a Hammer.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning, I'd hammer in the evening, all over this land. I'd hammer out danger, I'd hammer out warning, I'd hammer out love between my brothers and my sisters all over this land. Ooh, now I have a bell, I'd ring it in the morning, I'd ring it in the evening, all over this land. Sisters all over this land. Ooh, if I had a song, I'd sing it in the morning, I'd sing it in the evening, all over this land. I'd sing out danger, I'd sing out warning, I'd sing out love my brothers and my sisters all over this land. Ooh, well, I've got a hammer and I've got a bell and I've got a song to sing all over this land. It's the hammer of justice, it's a bell about love between my brothers and my sisters all over this land. Ooh.
Ooh. Thank you, Avi. That was wonderful. And now, let us close our service by extinguishing the chalice and reciting the following words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And so our service is concluded. Please feel welcome to stay for our very formal coffee hour. You'll have to provide your own coffee. You can now unmute yourself and use the chat function. And to see everyone's shining faces, please put your Zoom into gallery view at this time.